right. I think I'm on arriving here. Yeah, it's good to see you all. Good to feel you all. Good to feel that music, that message. Oh, I was feeling really moved by that. So that was Lindrell, the song Gratitude. And just how much context really, what's happening in our world. Our embeddedness is part of the whole picture. So yeah, just think about 2020 AD. Yeah. And this song is an offering, yeah, from a Black artist, 2020 AD. In a US context, we're in the height of some collective expression of distress, you know, no justice, no peace around the murder of George Floyd, around conditions here in the US, historically for Black folks. So just an amazing amount of creativity to like put that kind of medicine out in the world, like knowing that people are really struggling, you know, the context matters, right? That song happened in a context. It also keeps the portal open, like right now, you know, like that consciousness, like we're not done yet. Yeah. If justice is what love looks like in public, we're not done yet. So I'm glad you're here. All right. So just remember that we won't invite you to take care of your bodies, take care of yourselves. I see Karuna Bhappi is outside modeling different ways to be on screen that perhaps are very life enhancing. That looks just seeing your hair in the wind, unless that's a special effect, looks great. All that fresh air. So take care of yourself, you know, stretch, take care of your body, hydrate, look away from the screen every once in a while if that's helpful. So a reminder also that the recordings are available as we go, and maybe Diaketu can put those links in the chat now. I also want to say that Diaketu is in a home office, and he has two living beings there with him. And would you like to say who else is joining us, Diaketu, and their names? You can even show them to us, because it's really quite wonderful.
Yeah, it's are my two dogs. One is around there.
Deal.
Yeah.
And what are their names?
Is Frida and Diego. You cannot see them very well. Maybe just let the head of one. The full body of the other one.
I love that these dogs are named Frida and Diego. We were having a little imagining that at night they get up and paint together while we're all sleeping. Yeah, so decided to dedicate to who's holding tech for us. And I just share the link for the website where all the recordings are being, and some resources are being posted. There was a request for a recorded stupa practice that's on the Padlet. I uploaded one. It's on the Padlet, and it's also on the resource page. And the Padlet's where, you know, it's ours. The Padlet is ours as a community. So I've seen some very heartfelt sharings on there. And you can heart someone's post just to let them know they've been received. And there's been some messaging back and forth. Okay, so we are, we're in arriving practice. We're arriving in community, yeah. And here we are, we're in arriving. Look, Diana's, Diego and Frida, there's somebody else saying hi to you and Diana's screen. Diana, is there a name of this pup? So Diego and Frida can know what their playmate's name is. Frida?
This is Paddy.
Oh.
She's from Romania.
She's from Romania? Wow. How much welcoming Patty's getting. It's fantastic. All right. Does anyone else, you know, it's amazing how like, petting little soft furry creatures can be so soothing. I was in the park the other day and I saw a little fluffy puppy and it was just ridiculous. I was with a friend and it wasn't our puppy. this puppy came by and it was just like an explosion of joy just touching this puppy. It was so fluffy that like you went to pet it and your hands went in like a good 6 inches. It was just like all fluff with a little tiny body inside. It was just silly. And then it was so fluffy, you know, it came to say hi and it like just kind of leaned on us and just sort of flopped. It was the sweetest ever. Yeah, so let's just take a moment to imagine. Just imagine how that kind of pure, simple delight and wonder, a puppy's exhibit that we can have when we're just like, oh, so sweet meeting Daiketu's pups over there. Yeah, just let ourselves have this moment. I find that sometimes I'm just I get kind of serious in a way that's like really like heavy duty, like extra serious, unnecessary. So I wonder if we could just kind of have a little moment of joy and just being here and seeing what some people's backgrounds maybe. Like a little home decor tour. What's going on? Tratatara has a very nice something in the background. They're like a fantastic solar array behind you. Oh, and a pup. You have a pup. Who's your pup?
It's Bella.
Bella? Oh, it's a kitty.
She loves being on Zoom, as you'll have noticed.
That's who that's been. Nice. Is there anything anyone have gratitude for this morning you want to let us know about? You can just put it in chat. Gratitude, appreciation. We can have an ode to life, just a little basking in the small things. Or maybe the big things. Anyone want to unmute something you're grateful for? Quite grateful to get Manit Garba just demonstrating the way to relax. That's very good. Demonstration, Manit Garba. I think you look more relaxed than the kitty cat. That's pretty good.
I'm grateful for Akashivana's old rocking chair.
Oh. Ooh, that looks nice. Are you in the Spanish countryside, friend?
Yeah, I'm an hour and a half from Akashivana.
Some gratitude for all the memories there and the people there, yeah, in this place. Thank you. Is it, am I saying your name, Books? Is that right? Books. Gratitude for this space. Gratitude for you, sibling. I felt you vibing with that portal of the song, and yeah, it's good to be in community with you. Singashri, wanted to go swimming and got the 50 meter heated Lido. What's Lido? 10-minute walk from my house.
It's a Lido. It's a British word for pool, for outdoor pool. It's a very specific outdoor public pool.
Wow. Thank you for the people that made that possible. I'm grateful you got that in. Angela, this cold water. Fantastic. I love that. Maybe during one of our breaks, we can join you and people can go run their hands under cold water. It's quite lovely to do that, yeah. Oh, Monica, were you gonna say something from your perch?
Yeah, sorry, I'm laying down. I'm a bit tired, but I'm very grateful for being here with you all. Although lying down. And I've got my, you will be surprised to see.
Hello. Oh, walking away now. Like, nope, I'm yeah, walking walk away.
Walk away. He doesn't like to be on Zoom. But anyway.
Oh, good to see
my
you.
My sweet little cat is here too. So I'm grateful for that.
Yeah.
Here he is.
Oh, all right. Guest appearance. Gita, feeling extremely privileged to be here with you all. The universe is shining on me for sure. Gratitude for my daughter, Katie. Aw. Just feeling that human-shaped pause called Katie that we can take in. Yeah. Dai Katie, grateful for you all being here and all practicing together. Chittamodini, great gratitude for the metta practice this morning. Rebecca, gratitude for soft, fresh, limey, green, the leaves. Tejani, did you want to say something?
Yes. Whilst I was shoveling about half a ton of dung earlier in the break, I was just thinking how much gratitude I have to the team who must, for all the hard work you've done on yourselves to enable your teaching and wisdom, to, you know, kindness, all these great qualities come through. So I really appreciate this. Thanks. Yeah. And I have a meditating dog beside me.
He's like, okay, we were shoveling dung. Now it's time to relax. Thank you for that. All right, so thank you for your messages. I want to hand over to Balajit for what's next. So I won't read them all, but they're here. We can put them in the Padlet too, so we can just, it's a bit of a poem, isn't it? We could just, it's very, yeah, very much like mudita. And I just actually, again, the difference between events and experiences. And this thing about how much do we have space to feel, you know, just to let them ripple, let things ripple through us. Yeah. So gratitude for you all. Over to Balajit.
Great, thank you, Viveka. Yeah. Yeah, it's been great seeing the little furry friends in people's homes kind of appearing and disappearing, the odd tail and alarmingly cute puppies and things like that. Yeah. Good. Today I'm going to give a little bit of a talk on emotional, what I'm calling emotional dynamics. So sit as or lie as comfortably as you can. So I was thinking earlier, you know, the journey's continuing here, isn't it? But we had I thought really thorough input from Viveka on the ways of working with emotion, you know, a really inclusive sort of spirit of the broad categories or toolkits that we can apply, you know, to help bring more ease, more less conflict, more energy and so on into our lives on an emotional level. And then Singhasri then went on and condensation of the four foundations of mindfulness into kind of practical invitations, you know, these four questions. What's actually happening? How is it? How am I with it? and what else is possible. So for me, in a way, that's kind of it's like an invitation to the present moment, you know, in these the detail, subtlety and nuance and richness and different dimensions of the present moment. So bringing present moment, coming into relationship with the mystery and depth of the present moment. And today what I wanted to do was to home in a bit on emotions. And I'd like to share some kind of what I've seen as kind of common dynamics in us humans of emotions and how they play out. And hopefully that will stimulate maybe some curiosity, more curiosity in your own patterns of your own emotional life, and some of the potential, you know, for practice to free ourselves from restriction, you know, so we can be kinder to ourselves and start opening to our potential, you know, as positive agents for change in the world, you know. So it is a really, it's obviously a really complex area. So I'm just going to put some ideas and perspectives out there. I'm aiming for it to be a slow gallop, so to kind of get through material, but not too quickly. This is a quote I keep coming back to from Chogram Chomper, the American, the Tibetan Buddhist that came to the West. The everyday practice is simply to develop a complete acceptance and openness to all situations and emotions and to all people, experiencing everything totally without mental reservations and blockages, so that one never withdraws or centralizes into oneself. I love the way there he says simply to develop a complete acceptance and openness to all situations and emotions. So in a way, that's, we could say, the ideal, you know. And on this retreat, we've been trying to hold a sense of the ideal, but then also, becoming interested and curious about what's actually going on in our experience. You know, where are we actually? You know, and inevitably there's a tension in that, you know, in that kind of relationship. And I mean, my experience has very much been that, my journey really was to start with, I'd say that a strong degree of dissociation from the body. I started practicing in my late 20s. And my body was largely numb, and I wasn't even aware that it was numb. You know, the level of dissociation from my body was that level. I was numb, but I wasn't really largely numb, but wasn't even aware that I was numb. And I mean, one of the things for me in terms of turning towards being with, feeling into, that awareness, bringing aliveness into the body, has been of meeting like a community of energies, you know, that for me, like the body is like a community of energies that are interacting, you know. It's like a kind of playground, you know, in a way of interaction. And what does Buddhist practice mean to come into relationship with that in a way that can resolve conflicts in the community, you know, our internal community, so to speak, you know, scraps in the playground that have been going on for decades and things, and bring more harmony and flow. So what I'd like to do is, I don't want to do this on my own. I've got some friends that are going to help me out with this. So I'd like to do this visually. So this is my first friend. He's slightly uncreatively called Mickey. So that's Mickey. So Mickey is symbolizing, actually maybe I'll move a bit closer here. Mickey is symbolizing some energy in the mind, yeah, that just arises. So I'm gonna do the mindfulness of breathing with Mickey here. So bear with me. So the invitation of the practice is to bring awareness to the breath. So I'd like you to imagine that my face is awareness or attention. And I know this is a little bit odd, but for me, you're the breath. You're the sensations of the breath. You know, there's lots of like little movements and things going on, things arising and passing. And then, so I'm imagining basically that I'm focusing on the breath here. You know, I'm feeling the chair. And then what starts to come up is I'm starting and images start to form of the holiday I'm going on. So it starts to come up, and then there comes that point where attention sort of turns towards the holiday, and then it kind of come under the sort of spell of the images and thoughts about the holiday, the food, the fresh mountain breezes. You've lost the connection with the breath and the body. And then there comes this point, very mysterious, where something happens where you fall out of the fantasy of the holiday. And then, oh, here I am. I'm in the room. Oh, I'm meditating. You know, and then there might be, you may then decide to kind of come back to the breath, you know, come back to the feeling sense of the body. Or if you're like me, you fall out of the fantasy briefly, you contemplate going back to the breath, and then you go, oh no, I would just stay with the fantasy actually. And you go back to the kind of fantasy of things. And then something happens and you come out, and then there's awareness, and then there's awareness of the breath. So with this, you know, how are you with being distracted? You know, what goes on in you when there's this process of attention on the breath, intoxication with images and thoughts, and then you notice you're back again? You know, how do you hold that? Is there a sense, for example, this is the results of past actions, this pattern of being intoxicated into a stream of sense desire and getting lost in it? To some extent, that's inevitable. I'm in the process and it takes time. And I'm going to be kind of gentle and allow myself and come back with the breath. Or does what come in some kind of self-rejection? So I've got another little friend for this. It's a slightly more dramatic friend. So this is Kwok. Look on there, it's Kwok. So I keep getting distracted, and then this is the energy that can come up of self-rejection. You know, ah, rah, 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 I'm a failure. You know, it's ah, rah, 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 rah. Why can't I do this? I've been meditating for 20 years. Kind of maybe quite harsh attacking kind of energy or quality to it. Hatred, the hatred poison, you know, kind of turning against ourselves is one way of describing that. So I don't know if this kind of dynamic feels familiar to you in any way. But sometimes we can really not want to see this in ourselves, you know? So sometimes this can kind of be happening and invested in heavily, but doesn't have the benefit of being held with awareness and kindness and curiosity, you know? So here, my orientation isn't to try and stop doing this. It's more like to think, oh, yeah, I'm noticing this arising and passing, this arising and passing. So that's an example with sense desire. So I want to go a little bit deeper now. And put the crocodile back on, but this time on another hand. So this time I'm just sitting in the conservatory and I start to feel some anger. Yeah, so this time crocs just anger, yeah. So I'm feeling angry about the fact that my neighbor uses the leaf blower weekly. I'm feeling angry about that. You know, I can't get any peace and quiet. And I've just come back from work, whatever the situation. So, so this is the next character. So I once asked a group what to call this figure. There we go. So this is, although there's a cross around their neck, this is Buddhist Mr. Goody Two Shoes. So this is Buddhist Mr. Goody Two Shoes. So a lot of these are based on dynamics I've noticed in myself, which I get the sense I'm not alone with. So yeah, so some anger comes up. And then often what happens with the arising of emotion is that with the arising of a particular emotion like anger comes the counter to the emotion. So often we might experience these arise simultaneously, you know. So we've got the anger coming up, and then it's not often you see a monk attack a crocodile, but this is an example of that. So then the Buddha Two Shoes energy in us feels it's not skillful. It's not what the Buddha did. And it comes across, and then we try and push down the anger. Yeah, try and push down the anger. And then this creates a lot of tension in the body. You know, we've got a conflict going on here. There's a current, a momentum of feeling angry, and then there's a current, a momentum of resisting that anger. So just changing puppets with this a bit, just to go a little bit deeper. Something like this can also, in my experience, have underneath it an older strategy. So this is the thing, everything here, all these energies tend to have their integrity, you know, and can be understood when they're sensed and known. Is that the anger comes up, and then something in us, this time I'm presenting it with the monkey, comes into opposition with the anger. So there's a pushing down, it may have gone on a long time. But with mindfulness of the body and awareness and increasing clear comprehension of the arising and passing of experience, we might start to sense that this part has a voice, you know? This part, say, is fearful. It doesn't want me to be like my dad. You know, there's a belief there and fear driving it. It doesn't want to be like my dad. Or it fears that if I allow the anger, if anger is allowed, it will destroy and I'll be abandoned. You know, these can have really strong charges to them. You know, at some point, often in childhood, we developed a karmic momentum that anger can lead to isolation, you know, and abandonment. So And so there can be a lot of energy pushing down and a lot of energy wanting to come up. And so often these kind of conflicts, I think, go on, and we might not be aware of them at all, you know, but the toll on our being and on our mental and emotional health can be quite strong. But practice can start us to gradually bring more awareness and space, and to start allowing these energies in us to start feeling seen, valued and heard. You know, which is very powerful, has a very powerful impact on them. So one of the things I wanted to say here is so often the inner conflict, it's not just between anger, say, it's not just a conflict between anger and pushing down anger. It's so often that it's these inner conflicts that make the general nervous system feel overwhelmed, that then sends us up into anxiety or sends us down into that kind of shutdown mode, you know, where we start to feel flat and low and apathetic. So it's so often the charge of this, something happens and the charge of it, something makes us feel angry, and then it fires up this, and the charge of that in the system short fuses it, you know. We might not see that this is why this is kind of happening, really. But this is all the potential when a mindfulness is emerged in the body, you know, to use what the Buddha said. So what I find really helpful is to have this orientation to feel, see and value and know the yes and the no, you know. Yes, I want to be angry, and then there's a no, I don't want to be angry. And meditation has a real potential for this. And what would it be like if both start to be seen, felt and known as they are, you know, if they can be kind of separated out a bit, and giving them the space to kind of to flow, and for there to be more movement, you know, and some of the energies in these parts to kind of release and discharge. So this is possibly one of the most important points for me in this kind of work is the difference between experiencing and behavior. You know, I think a lot of our difficulty with emotion and allowing emotions to flow is that we feel that if we feel anger, we will act angrily. You know, that if I allow myself to feel some of the strength and boundary settingness and protest in me over something, I will inevitably then act in a way that will cause harm to other people and myself, and I'll end up abandoned. This is such a common belief. So that's acting out is very, very different from developing the resilience to just meet life, for the different emotions to come up, to feel their energy and strength in an embodied awareness, holding that in a wider sense of awareness that has a bigger perspective, knowing that the emotion has a lifespan, you know, that when it's allowed, it has its moment, and then it kind of passes. So yeah, difference between behavior and experiencing. I mean, repressed anger is, I think, probably the major cause of anxiety, you know, not being able to tolerate anger in the body. And repressed anger, from my experience, tends to turn against the self. So it's very linked with self-hatred, lack of self-worth, feeling bad, this attacking of the self. So this area for me has a huge amount of scope, you know, in terms of being able to, what are we doing to our anger, and can we develop the capacity to feel the charge of the anger in the body without acting out and without turning it against ourselves and things. I'm just going to take a little personal intermission here just to kind of rotate my ankles. So you're welcome to join me or any other limbs or joints. Yeah, we'll just have a little intermission. I can't bring around ice creams, I'm afraid, or popcorn. It's not the cinema. But let's have a little intermission. Okay, so part two is about to start. Part two of the puppet show. So this is a bit more of a personal story for me. So this time the monkey's grief. So grief. And so something completely unexpectedly started to arise in me about 2 years ago from absolutely nowhere that completely threw me, is that I started to, with no apparent reason, I started to kind of experience the swelling up of grief. I would feel, I'd start to feel really yucky inside, and then the grief, I was touching the edges of the grief. In a way, it was like the grief was trying to come into me. And then what happened was that my being was going into the, I sat with it one time, and my being was going into this tussle. Like on one hand, there was this sense of it's not okay to feel grief. And then on the other hand, there was a sense of, is it okay to feel grief, you know? And I had like kind of tears streaming down my eyes, you know, as it cracked. And I suddenly realized it was okay to feel grief, you know. And then what happened is that I had, it was about 2 months, pretty daily, of these waves coming from nowhere, of feeling yucky inside, and then feeling the relief of all this sobbing. You know, it was a real deep body sobbing. And it went on for week after week after week, you know, and there was nothing, there's no memory. Sometimes there was a word that might resonate it with, like loss, you know, like there's a particular word that might resonate, but very limited, any verbal link or no memory. And then at some point after about 2 months, it quietened down and subsided. But one of the fruits of that has lasted for me, and that is that ever since that time, around that time, is that I think it really helped me move out of patterns of just dissociating, you know. I'd have this pattern, I wouldn't know why, but, you know, something would happen and then I'd feel quite numb, dull, I'd lose my memory, I'd lose confidence. I feel quite apathetic. There was something, I know now there was some kind of shutdown against something in me. And there was something around this whole period of grief where that happens less now, you know. Something that was previously overwhelming, my system had learned to tolerate. And yeah, Boogs, integration. I was able to integrate that side of me. And one of the things that my work as a trauma therapist that never continues to amaze me is how much emotion can be locked in us humans in freeze. You know, there's so much energy for so many of us that is locked away in freeze, you know. And for me, this was the grief aspect, some of the grief aspect kind of coming through. So I just wanted to now just make a few points around emotional aliveness or freeing up emotions in the body that hopefully you'll find helpful. Just a few perspectives. So for me, grief was a taboo emotion. You know, that may have, I imagine that part of that may have been my conditioning as a man, as a male. It was definitely in my mid-Essex comprehensive school in southeast England, a feeling that, that grief wasn't something that the proper men showed, you know. It was a sign of weakness. May reflect some parenting attitudes to grief, you know, a parent's attitude to grief. Western white male, there might be no doubt forces driving the judgments against grief, you know. So one question that I find quite helpful, if you're aware that there's an emotion that sends you into anxiety or you find really hard to feel, or you're aware you're closed down in, is what do I fear would happen if I started to feel this? You know, what do I fear would happen if I allowed myself to feel this? So for grief, for me, it would have been a feeling of shame and humiliation and weakness, you know, shame, humiliation and weakness. And so see, this is part of trying to see value and hold, you know, and honor the no in us, you know, because that question can evoke what might be driving the no or the pushing down in us. So something starts to feel heard and seen, you know. So another perspective is we tend to, in our language, we can easily call emotions troubling. One way I prefer to approach this now is that through our lack of trust and our judgments, that we trouble emotions, you know. The emotions in themselves, in embodied awareness, they have their moment. There's some kind of communication just pass through, but it isn't. It's you know, that's the trouble, the resistance kind of thing. As we know in Buddhism, you know, the life in our senses is subject to arising and passing. So what experiences self arises and self subsides or self liberates, you know, once left and seen as it is in the space to do that. Another perspective is which, you know, there's so much happening in this field in science at the moment, is what happens in the body around emotions that are bound in the body that haven't been fully lived. You know, we know now that it dysregulates systems in the body, skin, digestion, hormonal, that it drives syndromes, migraines, autoimmune, fibromyalgia, and so on. And there's this huge study in America, the Adverse Childhood Experiences Study, you know, which is worth looking at, which shows the relationship between adverse experiences in childhood and health conditions and so on in later life. So a couple of other things is I do feel there's huge potential for change here, you know, however shut down we are or alienated from emotion. I do feel, you know, there is scope for deep and fundamental change, really, that emotional resilience can be built, you know, and what was bound in the body can be freed up to flow. And I think titration's a really important concept here. Some of you might be familiar with that, you know, that we start to feel a little bit of the grief, you know, and then if it gets a bit too much, we start to get anxious, or we start to feel a bit spacey, we can go and resource. But then maybe we can feel a little bit more, helping the body feel safe to connect with itself again, you know. And as we build, as resilience, emotional resilience increases, the vulnerability to overwhelm decreases, you know. Yeah, so as we build resilience, the our susceptibility to overwhelm will kind of decrease. For me, it's like going, you know, to the doing weight training. You know, you're not going to develop muscle if you just feel you're just going to dive into grief and just really want to feel it, and you know, and you're not going to develop muscle or resilience with a difficult emotion if you keep avoiding it. But if you find, you know, and work with the right level of challenge, you know, and are sensitive to that, gradually the system can hold more, you know. So yeah, this is a phrase I heard this morning that really resonated with me, is love brings up what's not love. So love brings up what's not love. So how do I say this? So yeah, as we kind of become present with the feeling life of our body, and then maybe we have periods of relaxation and spaciousness, that is the very conditions that then will attract the unresolved. You know, what wants love will be drawn to love, or what needs love will be drawn to love. So I think it's really helpful to expect a pendulation here, you know, the clock pendulating. So we have periods of expansion and metta. And then that is the very felt safety in the body and kindness felt in the body is the conditions that thaws, freeze, you know, that thaws what's locked away. That's what the frozen parts of us need. You know, and then when the thaw of the freeze happens, we start to get the life and energy of what was once too much, what was once too much for us to feel. Reginald Ray calls it the unlived in us. You know, we didn't have the resources at the time to better cope with the intensity of that feeling, and the system is designed to lock it away and freeze, and that comes out. And then maybe we metabolize some of that, you know, integrate, absorb, and we're regulated enough that the systems of the body are enough online to process that emotion in a way they weren't earlier. It's likely we'll then have periods of expansion and so on. And eventually, so my teachers tell me, we're just left with the vast open blue sky of loving awareness, you know. The pendulation gradually comes to a halt. So I'm just keeping an eye on time here. So I hope you're still with me. Another thing here is somehow it's easy to get the sense that I'm just working through the difficult emotions and habits that I've developed in this life, you know. So I found it quite helpful. It's a bit like at the cinema, you know, just before the feature comes on and suddenly the screen goes into widescreen. This wasn't on my radar before, but I think if it can be on in your sense of things, it can make it more likely that the healing can go deeper. And that is that what might be bound in my body may not just be this life. You know, what might be bound in my body may not just be this life. That there's past life, our bodies are holding, and it's likely to have past life imprints in it. And it's, whether you believe in past lives, you know, you can hold that lightly. Inevitably, I'd say, is going to have ancestral trauma in the body. And then there's all the traumas for, you know, groups of people, racial trauma and things that's inevitably carried over and passed down through generations. So in internal family systems therapy, they call it the legacy burden, you know, that we inherit emotions, energies and beliefs that it would be too simplistic to think that was all, you know, a result of actions and experiences in this life. And I had a very vivid and striking experience of this myself, actually, on the ancestral side. So I just want to just briefly share that with you. So this was a few years ago, and I was waking up with this kind of strange energy at night. I had no idea what was going on, but I just allowed it. And this went on over weeks, you know, and it would wake me up and I'd have this spell of this strange energy. And then on one day I was going out for a walk with Eve, my partner, and yeah, it's quite strong, this. Yeah, it was one of the
Balajit,
one of the most, say?
No, with you, you just take a moment, you know, just
to, yeah. Okay. It was one of the kind of lowest days of my life, really. And yeah, we were walking up this hill, and yeah, we got to the top. Just as we were getting to the top, I got this tremendous sense of grief came over me, and I kind of broke down in it. And what burst in was I was feeling the grief, you know, that my aunts and uncle felt when they lost their dad, and my mum, they lost their dad, who was shot down in the Second World War. And you know, it clearly wasn't mine, but I was feeling it. And it came wave after wave, but it felt very kind of rich and connecting. You know, it was like I'd entered a field of something, you know. And then, funnily enough, we got to the top of this hill, and I'd felt through this waves, and then I just felt like dancing. You know, this is dancing energy came into me. And it happened to be just at the point of the top of the hill where suddenly, as we walked down, the countryside got really, really beautiful. It was like full of all these colors, you know. And yeah, it was very, very, very strong experience of something kind of moving through me that wasn't me, you know. So I'm very surprised with what's just come up for me there, actually. It's kind of, you know. So so yeah, again, you know, we come back to this, maybe the spirit of openness and a welcoming space for all to be known, seen, felt, and unfold, and a gradual process. And for me, that's all kind of driven just by being open and sensitive to the body. We don't need to go looking, you know, just being present and go on this journey of integration and healing and things. The nose can, you know, can often be about expansion, expansive emotions as well. So, you know, I don't think the nose just apply to the contracted emotions. And one of the final things I wanted to say was just the in this area of just being careful about being too goal oriented, you know, because it can be tempting, you know, I want to feel good and expansive emotions. For me, that's a little bit like trying to fly a kite that's tied to a brick. You know, it's like trying to fly a kite that's tied to a brick. So my sense is we need to get curious about the brick, really. You know, we need to get curious about the brick. And that needs metta, you know, the brick, the weight, what holds us back, so to speak, needs metta. Otherwise, it's likely to dig its heels in. You know, we know that in life, don't we? If any time we feel ignored or pushed aside, not listened to, we tend to harden, you know. So, yeah, good. So, I think that's it. Thank you for joining me on that journey. Yeah, thank you for joining me on that journey. I hope it's giving you some things to reflect on. It's just coming up to 5 o'clock now. No, it's five. Sorry, it's just coming up to the top of the hour. So what I suggest we do is we just have a 15-minute break now, and then we'll come back into home groups. Yeah. Take care.
I'm just wanting to take a moment to just really, you might be quite stirred. I just want to just take a moment before we just go off. It's quite hard to hold space. And then just want to just have a breath with you, Balajit. And just also have a breath with yourself. Just letting that ripple. Yeah. And yeah, there's lots of love being expressed to you, Balajit, in the chat. And hopefully you can feel that, people being with you and I think quite moved by what you're sharing. Singhashi, I think some announcement about groups. Yeah, about if people don't want to be in groups. Do you want me to just do that?
Okay, welcome back from your groups. I hope that was a rich time to be able to share a bit with others around what's coming up for you. So let's just, as we arrive at the end of this want to say afternoon so badly, but it's not afternoon everywhere. What is it? Middle of this middle section. Let's just do a little bit.
10 a.m. in California.
Yes, that, oh, such a wonderful time in San Francisco, 10 a.m. Usually there's still a bit of fog and then it all lifts by noon. Or at least that's how it used to be when I lived there.
There's definitely been a bit of fog. I'm not sure about the lifting part. I'll cross my fingers.
Yeah. Well, you live in the foggiest part of town, I think. All right. So let's just do a little bit of orienting because it looks like that's what my system is wanting. So just gently looking around the room, taking in the space. Colors, shapes, shadow, light. And then sensing into what's here now internally. Sensations, thoughts, emotions. And then if we could go to gallery view and just taking each other in, taking in the whole beloved community of this retreat. We've been commenting in our team meetings how it really feels like a retreat. I don't know how it is for you, but there's something about the depth we've been able to go to, and we're about halfway through now. So there's still a lot further to go. Really enjoying being on this journey with you. So just a couple of things before we end. One is that we've got the Padlet for capturing anything out of your small group. So do go ahead and drop into, not actually sure where that should go in the Padlet, because we've got quite a lot already. Maybe under in the comments in the section, teaching section. So emotional dynamics, input from Balajit, and there's a picture of a monkey smiling. So in there, you could put your comments from coming out of groups, or you could just drop them into the chat and we'll capture them and drop them into Padlet for you. And we will harvest from there when we come back in the evening. Sorry, in a late section. So yeah, and then Viveka wants to say something about what we'll be doing in that last session of the day.
Yeah. So we will have some time to just explore what's resonating as we have the harvest part. So there'll be some space for that. And then the second part, the practice portion, we'll be doing some Tonglen practice together. We'll also have a chance for a compassion or healing ritual, compassion ritual. And in that, there'll be an opportunity to share, bring together our wishes for healing for our world and the context we're in, for ourselves. Yeah. Anything that comes to you is healing wishes. So you might want to have that, something that's with you. And then we'll be able to offer them in the chat at some point in the ritual with the mantra. Or you could just do that, you know, just from your heart. You don't have to be typing if you just want to put it out in a practice sort of way.
And Viveka, can that include wishes for others' healing as well?
Yeah, that's right. Anyone, that's, yes.
Yeah, so anyone we know who might be suffering right now. Okay, thank you so much. So we'll see you in an hour and a half, and do feel free to make any reactions or unmute yourself to say goodbye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Sending love.
Thank you. Lots of love.
Thank you for everything. It's great.
Yeah. Beautiful session. Thank you very much.
Another beautiful session.